Well, welcome to another edition of the Digicel Sports Show right here on IslandStats.com. I'm your host, Earl Bazin, and welcome back to Jason, Juggling Jay Ford. Jay, it's been several different things happening in the world of sports locally since you've been abroad. I'll leave it at that, abroad. But you've had a chance to take in some of the events, being from overseas and looking back at Bermuda. What's been your thoughts over the past week and what you're looking forward to this week? We're here at the Belmont Hills Golf Course, day two of the Goslin's Invitation. It moves up to Port Royal Wednesday and Thursday, but let's go back. What did you think of the week of sports that you were abroad?
Well, Earl, being away from the island for a bit, but one thing, the island's name is being spoke about overseas. Very strangely enough, just in conversation with the hotel people, people at the front desk, when you say Bermuda, they're mentioning the America's Cup. They're mentioning golf tournaments. And these are people I've never met in my life, and they know about Bermuda when it comes to these sports. So in that sense, you feel that sense of pride. Yeah, come on down, and let's come to the America's Cup, or come to the golf tournaments that we are having here. It's definitely a good feeling, and to know that 21 square miles, we're making a mark around the world.
Well, we're going to have more on golf, football, and many more sports after this message from our sponsor.
Bermuda, listen up. D-Music is here exclusively for Digicel customers. Open up a world of music at your fingertips and access millions of songs from free. With D-Music, you can easily search for your favorite artists and create playlists to fit your lifestyle. Plus, you have the option to download music to your device so you can find a song for any moment, even when offline. D-Music comes with 1 gig of free data to stream and download songs without it impacting your data usage. That's 32 hours worth of music. Visit us in-store or online to see how you can get D-Music today.
Well, as we said, Jay, we're here at the Belmont Hills Golf Course, where yesterday on day one, it was a course record, 12 under par, 58. Unbelievable here. Goslin's, the golf course is all a buzz, but day two, different day, a little bit of breeze. Let's see how the golfers made out. The Goslin's Invitational started off with an amazing day of history of the Belmont Hills and the invitation itself. Canadian professional Denny King, seen here teeing off today, broke not only the Belmont course record, but the Goslin's Invitational individual daily record of 62, with a new record of 12 under par, 58. A great way to start this historical event, now in its 51st year. Fellow Canadian David Witthoff, King's partner, carded an 8 under par, 62. In the open gross division, Damian Paliande goes into day two leading with a 2 over par 72, with Stefano Barani leading the net division with an even par 70. Glenn Kelly enjoyed a good day, carding an even par 70, and Jeff Pigott is leading the senior net division with 64. Nick Jones leads the Bermuda players in the professional division, carding an even par 70 that sees him tied 9th, while Kamiko Smith and Brian Morris are tied 14th, one stroke back. Well, this past weekend, the Bermuda Football Association's league tables up and down. As we all know, PHC are leading the Premier Division. Defending champions Dundee Town Hornets are at the bottom of the Premier Division. In the First Division, Young Men's Social Club, who were undefeated, still are undefeated, but their 100% record is gone. They drew 1-1 with St. George. And at the bottom of the table, Island Rangers are once again struggling. But to nobody's surprise, Paget with an influx of players are coming to life.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen the progression of Paget over the last couple of seasons. Once upon a time, we even mentioned they was conceding over 100 goals a season. I think they're only about 16, 17 after 7 games, I believe. So just that alone, you're only looking at a goal to 2 goals per game. And I think that in itself, I mean, it's got to be commended. But with the type of quality players that they have brought in, the likes of Dion Stubble, who's always been a goal approacher. I mean, he can put the ball in the back of the net. He's come in late. I don't think he started the first couple of games, but he scored in the last couple of games. So just that alone, once you have a player like that who has the confidence to put that ball in the back of the net, we see that with the difference with Bolivar, with having Ian Koch in the squad, Kyle Jones, he's starting to fire again up with Darren Schultz. We see what happens when these type of players put the ball in the back of the net. And I think this is probably one of the things that Dandytown Hornets are missing, because once again, it feels like deja vu, because 2 years ago they hadn't recorded a win at this time in the season, and yet 2 years later, even though they are the league champions, they have yet to record a win this season.
Things are rough. Actually, it feels a little worse for them because the way they're losing. They were that season before. They weren't leaking in as many goals. They were more competitive. Not saying they're not competitive, but it feels a lot worse. I watched a bit of Dandytown and Devonshire Colts on Sunday. It just didn't feel like they were in the game itself.
Well, I think that lends to, you know, when you have those expectations and then they're not being met, then the frustration starts. And now, you know, that's when you get to start getting the red cards that we got to see the other day. Injuries, you know, the groin pulls, the hamstring pulls, and that lends to frustration, because now you see one of your influential players go off the field injured, even though they have Kwame Steed in there who's just coming in, so he's still having a little bit of time to, you know, gel amongst the team. And I know he's going to probably pay big dividends to this team, but right now they are, I'm pretty sure they're probably more frustrated because of the expectations. They expect to be a lot higher than they are. I mean, if you look at it now, PAC has got 19 points. Dandytown has 1. So you can almost kiss the league. The league's going. And just that alone, I mean, that's one of the prize cups that, if you ask Coach Wilkinson, that's one of the prize cups they love to have around at the St. John's facility.
The PAC Zebras are the league leaders with 19 points, while the North Village Rams are in second with 16 points. Robin Hood are in third with 14 points. Shane Hollis from the North Village Rams is the early league leader, scoring 11 league goals thus far. Ian Koch from the Boulevard Blazers is in second with 9 goals. Sequoia Robinson from the PAC Zebras, Antoine Russell from Robin Hood, Angelo Simmons from the Dandytown Hornets, and Kyle Jones from Devonshire Colts all have 5 goals on the season. In First Division, Young Man Social Club remained the only undefeated team in the league with 19 points from 7 games. Crossroads holds second place with 16 points, while Southampton Rangers are in third with 13 points. James Pace from St. David's, Clay Darrell from Young Man Social Club, and Jakari Ferbert from BAA all have found the back of the net 6 times to lead the league in the goal scoring department. Jay, last week it was announced that Bermuda could possibly be hosting a World Triathlon Championship. Something that I can get excited about, and I know other Bermudians can get excited about, as this will be an opportunity for Bermudians not only to volunteer and be on the sideline, but to also take part in, as age group championships are involved. So it's more of a buy-in. I know the America's Cup is it's a huge thing for Bermuda, but for the triathlon, it'll be actually participation, something that I think more Bermudians will rally to get behind.
Well, I think it's best of both worlds. I mean, like you just said, I mean, even though we're going to have some world champions here on the island, but it also gives us a chance to also participate in the event. When we've seen the numbers increase, and then we have our own world champions, I'm pretty sure, I don't know yet, but I'm pretty sure they will be here for that. Florida Duffy, Tyler Butterfield. Hint, hint. But in saying that, the folks that do triathlons, this is their America's Cup. And if you understand that when you're in that sport, you're always looking to have the pinnacle event in your hometown. And then for us, it would be on our island. And if you're looking at today, here we are, the end of November, and the sun is shining bright, beautiful weather here. So I can't wait just to see the competition that reaches our shores.
Well, you named two current stars, but there are two others that I'm pretty sure will have their name in the hat as well, and that's Tyler Smith and Erica Hawley, two dominating youngsters who are applying their trades in colleges right now. Tyler's in the UK in Leeds training with the Brownlee brothers, but in the same school as the Brownlee brothers. And you have Erica Horley over in Colorado, where Tyler Butterfield and Flora Duffy have honed their skills. And so given a 3-year term, who knows, we could be top of the world at the senior level and top of the world at the youth level as well.
And that's what we want. You know, Earl, when we have the likes of, you know, in each sport, people paving the way, we basically want to pave the way for the next generation to come through. And now you're starting to see the next wave of athletes come through with the triathletes. And it's exciting times, I'm pretty sure. In the triathlon world, is definitely exciting times.
And it's also exciting times for swimming, as we had Lisa Blackburn, Emma Harvey, and Madeline Moore all compete recently in overseas competitions. Lisa Blackburn competed in the Florida Gold Coast 2016 Speedo Winter Championships. Blackburn won a bronze medal when she finished third in the women's 200-yard IM final, touching the wall in a time of 2:11.50. In the women's 50-yard freestyle final, Blackburn finished sixth with a time of 24:80. During the 59th English School Swimming Association National Relay Championships at the London Aquatic Centre, which was the host of the 2012 London Games, Madeline Moore and her Plymouth Lender college teammates retained their place as one of the country's big two as far as English school swimming is concerned. One of only two schools to break a national record and one of only three schools to bring home a gold, Plymouth Lander College, were headed by Millfield School, but were well clear both of Latimer School, who finished in third, and Mount Kelly. The Millfield School also hosts Emma Harvey from Bermuda. In true dominant style, the Plymouth Lander senior female 200-meter freestyle relay team were to take an English school's record, originally set in 2014. Moore and her teammates clocked a time of 1:45.37. Harvey was a member of the Millfield team that attended the swimming championship relays. Harvey was competing in the senior team division, coming away with a gold and a silver medal. Harvey led off the Millfield senior girls 200-meter relay medley team that captured gold with a time of 1:57.54. Harvey then swam the second leg for the Millfield school girls 200-meter freestyle relay team that won silver, stopping the clock in 1:47.33.
Open up a world of music at your fingertips and access millions of songs from free with D-Music, exclusively from Digicel. With D-Music, you can stream and download songs and create playlists of your favorite artists to fit your lifestyle. Whether you're working out at the gym, getting ready for a Friday night, or just chilling at home, D-Music comes with 1 gig of free data to stream and download songs without it impacting your data usage. That's 32 hours worth of music. Visit us in-store or online to see how you can get D-Music today.
Now we turn our attention to the sport of equestrian. Over the past week, we had Kaiwan Miners competing in Florida. We had Jillian Tessera competing in Belgium. And of course, harness racing in Bermuda. Let's get a look at those three sports taking place recently. Kaiwan Miners competed in the 2016 SJHJA 66 Annual Charity Horse Jumping Event in Florida. On day one, Miners finished fifth riding Lucky Guess during the Ed Back Hunter class. During the class 201 pre-green Hunter, 3'3", Miners and Freeport BF finished second. He also finished fourth riding Lucky Guess. Miners rode Lucky Guess to victory in class 203, the pre-green Hunter, 3'3" class, and he and Freeport finished fifth. Meanwhile, Jillian Tessera competed in Belgium in a CSI 2 and CSI 1 international horse jumping event. During the 1.10 meter CSI Table A against the clock class 1, Tessera and Chakova finished third with one penalty for point. Tessera and Escalada finished 36th with a time of 69.73 and 8 penalty for points during the 1.20 meter CSI 1 Table A against the clock class. Competing in the 1:35 meter CSI 2 Table A in two phases class, Tessera and Amarula finished 10th with a clear round time of 35.79. During the 1.10 meter CSI 1 Table A against the clock class, Tessera and Chakova finished 8th with a time of 59.64. On the local front, we cover all the stables in harness pony racing. Ryan Burrows in the Biker Sinfield Hard Times clocked the fastest time of the night while competing in the 104 and 4 and faster time bar. Burrows and Sinfield Hard Times stopped the clock in 104 flat. They were hard pressed by Tyler Lopes in the bike of Cherokee's Ironman, who finished second in the time of 104 and 1. Aaron Medeiros in the bike of IC Shakedown finished third in 105 and 1. In the 106 to 107 time bar class, Rio Patrol and Carissa Rabane clocked a winning time of 104 and 4, taking a leg out of the class. Inwards Generation and Christian Truin finished second in a time of 106 and 1. Ryan King in the bike of Black and Mile finished third in a time of 106 and 3. Lucas Bridges in the bike of Colonel's Maestro won the 106 and 1 to 107 and 1 time bar class with a time of 107 and 1. Lopes in the bike of Pastor Paul finished second in 107 and 2. Double Trouble with Nick DeCosta in the bike finished third in a time of 107 and 3. Jay Nepo, the Bermuda School Sports Federation held their middle and primary school championships last week, and the Youth Netball League got underway on Saturday at Bernard's Park. Let's see how everyone made out throughout last week and over the weekend. Soltis Grammar School scored in the dying seconds to come away with a 9-8 victory over T.N. Tatum Middle School in the Bermuda School Sports Federation Middle School Netball Championships. Soltis were led by Sayla Tuzo with 5 goals, while Ellen Butterfield added 4 goals. Zachary Turner and Adrielle Baston both scored 4 goals each for T.N. Tatum. Soltis overcame BHS in their semifinals 7-5, while Tatum needed sudden death overtime to defeat the Delwood Middle School 14-13. The Bermuda Netball Association's Youth League season got underway at Bernard Park on Saturday with the playing of the Harold Duck Dueling Tournament. In the under-12 division, the Phoenix Youngins went undefeated to win the division tournament, while the Storm finished second and the Warriors finished third. In the under-16 division, the North Village Lady Rams were crowned the champions, with the Storm Lightning finishing in second. Over in the senior division, the North Village Lady Rams defeated the Blazing Phoenix 48-41. Jatora Trott led the North Village Lady Rams to victory with 29 goals, while Chiquita Simmons added 19 goals. The Blazing Phoenix got 26 goals from Frederica Samuels, while 15 goals came from Damiqua Daniels. Ebony Burgess scored 20 goals to lead the Phoenix Heat to a 38-22 win over the Phoenix Flames. Arkita Fubler added 10 goals, and Dominique Richardson scored 4 times. The Robin Hood Ladies defeated the Storm 40-27. The Royal Rugby Classic came to an end a few weeks ago, Jay. League Rugby has kicked back in. The National Sports Centre, the main field, the stadium field, was the scene of some high-flying action on Sunday with women's league play in both the first and second division, and then some high scoring in the men's division. Let's take a look at some of the winners and some of the action from Sunday at the Sports Centre. The Bermuda Rugby Football Union's league season resumed at the National Sports Centre following the conclusion of the highly covered Bermuda World Rugby Classic. In the women's first team league play, the opening match saw the Police Ladies and the Renegades Ladies end in a 3-3 draw. Joe Murray scored 2 tries for the Police Ladies, while Sarah Hurston added the other. Melissa Franklin broke away from the pack twice to score 2 tries for the Renegades, while Leah Collis added the other. In the other game in the division, also ended in a draw, this time 1-1 between the Mariners Ladies and the Teachers Ladies. Gina Newsom scored the try for the Mariners Ladies, while the Teachers try came from Najee Pitt-Clark. In the game between the Renegades and the Police in women's two-division team play, it ended without either team reaching the touchline. Over in men's division play, the Renegades came from 20-12 down at halftime to defeat the Police 40-20 and cement their place at the top of the men's division. The Renegades got 2 tries from Janie Baum, while Sam Waters, Diallo Courtier, Cedric Innes, and John Quigley all added a try each, while Paul Kelly kicked 5 conversions. The Police got a try from Garrett Lemprachat and Stephen Smith, while Rick Lau kicked 2 conversions and 2 penalties. The Teachers scored deep into injury time to defeat the Mariners by a single point, 36-35 in Game 2. The Teachers got 2 tries from Jonathan Lightbourne with Tashan De Silva, Connor McGowan, Tyler Kendall, and Corey Boyce all adding a try each. McGowan added 3 conversions. Andre Bocanoc, Roy Dublin, Andrew Barnes, Randall Anderson, and Chioke Wainwright-Bayston all went over for the Mariners, with Dublin and Roy O'Kelly-Lynch both kicking a conversion and a penalty. Cedar Bridge Academy was the scene last night of the Bermuda Island Basketball League returning. They had played there on Saturday. There's been some ups and downs for them this year, having to move at the last minute. Location, sometimes at Summersfield, but they're back home at the Cedar Bridge Academy Gymnasium. And last night was two very interesting games that went down to the wire. The first one, although it finished with a wider margin, these Tsunamis didn't have it all their way. But let's take a look at how things materialized last night inside of Cedar Bridge Academy. Inside the Cedar Bridge Academy Gymnasium, it saw the Island Basketball League season continue with two good games that produced 226 points. Game 1 saw the Tsunamis remain undefeated on the season and moving their record to 9-0 by defeating the Court Kings 65-54. Dean Jones once again led the Tsunamis to victory with a season-high 30 points, while the Court Kings were led by Adam Correa with 18 points. Game 2 saw the Twisters get revenge over the Hoop Stars, who they lost to last week, defeating them 55-52. Alex Butterfield scored 21 points for the Twisters, while Junior Warner and Calvert Lee both scored 14 points for the Hoop Stars. Another sport starting last night, Jay, was the Bermuda Squash Association's Club Championships. Now, this is one where everyone wants to be the club champion, having their name on the wall for the year. Michael Franklin is not playing in this one. He's actually getting ready to go back abroad. He was abroad a few weeks ago playing in a tournament. So he's gearing up to go back and represent himself and Bermuda in another international tournament. But the club championships, it's a lot of action. Was there last night, saw the women's number one, Rachel Barnes, take on one of the Caribbean youth players that represented Bermuda. And it was funny enough that Patrick Foster, who's the pro at the squash club, said, you know what, that was Rachel who was taking on the youngster who was 10 years her junior. That was her 10 years ago taking on someone else in the club. So she would know how the youngster felt. And at the end of it, Rachel was seen talking to her, giving her some words of encouragement, just to let her know that, hey, I was in your shoes, and if you continue, you could be in my number one player, women's player in Bermuda. But let's see how everyone made out last night at the Squash Club. The Bermuda Squash Rackets Association Club's championships got underway in Devonshire last evening. One game in the men's open division went the distance, with Mark James coming from two games down to defeat Richard Brewer 7-11. 9-11, 11-8, 11-8, 13-11. Two ladies division matches also went five games, with Christine Barnes defeating Jane Craig 8-11, 11-6, 7-11, 11-5, 12-10. Christina Scoba defeated Jane Chapman 9-11, 13-11, 11-3, 7-11, 11-9. In other men's play, Pierre Carr defeated Anaya Smith 11-4, 11-6, 11-8. Mal Keynes got by Colin Cooper 11-1, 11-2, 11-4. And Anthony White defeated Matt Davis 3-11, 12-10, 11-8, 11-6. In other ladies division action, Rachel Barnes defeated Ariana Luther 11-5, 11-3, 11-3. Jane Chapman defeated Izzy White 11-8, 12-10, 11-3, and Denise Kime got by Sabrina Luther 11-9, 11-4, 11-8. Well, with Bermuda staying in Division 4, Jay, of the ICC cricket, I got a chance to speak with Stephen Douglas. He's the president of the Bermuda Umpires Association. He's also the president of Eastern County. Mm-hmm. We talked about his career as umpiring. We talked about the challenges umpires are facing. We talked about the challenges that Eastern County face. Let's get a take on, or let's hear what you were hoping to hear from Douglas regarding just cricket in general.
Well, you put me on the spot here. Well, after having many conversations with Mr. Douglas, he has a very passionate approach. No matter what form of the game, being an ex-player, also being an umpire, also being an administrator, very passionate. I'm pretty sure he likes to see some things be done differently. But he's seen the decline in our national team, obviously, up close, being in the middle. So he knows the frustrations, or he knows what's going on out in the middle. Unfortunately, he's not in a position to make much change, as he would love to be. Well, I'm pretty sure if you gave him the helm, the reins, he'll do a lot with it. But in saying that, I mean, I'm pretty sure on the other shoe, or the other foot, he feels that from the Eastern County side, because, you know, a few years ago we was hearing the Eastern County decline in numbers and even the competition, you know, should there be change, there have been made a couple of amendments. So he feels it on the administrative side also. So it'd be interesting to see how can he even know there's two personalities, because obviously I think with even within himself they're gonna probably clash at some point in time, depending on what hat he's wearing at the time.
Well, welcome to this special edition of the DigiSouth Sports Show. I'm joined by a DigiSouth employee, none other than Stephen Douglas, who wears many hats. But we want to get a chance to speak with Stephen today about his career at umpiring, his career at cricket, as well as being afforded the time off to see and do some of the things he's been allowed to do through DigiSouth. But first of all, thank you very much, Stephen, for allowing us to have a chance to chat with you. But take us through your umpiring career. When did you get started, and why did you get started?
First of all, thank you for having me here, and thank you for heading time off from work to be able to do this interview. I got started umpiring in 97, I believe it was. At that time, I had quit playing cricket, and I used to help up with a tea break. I used to come bring a bit of tea. After tea, I would either score or I would go at squirrel egg. So I decided that I wanted to get something back to the game, and which way could I do it, and I chose umpiring. And this is where I am. I got started in, I think, 97, and I just moved on from there.
The sport, as we see it nowadays, struggles for officials. We have an abundance of players. We always have that. But officials, what is the strength one needs to stand in the middle and sort of administrate a game from an official standpoint?
Well, first of all, you must have love for the game. You must love what you can do. If you're coming out there just for the money or something of that nature, that makes sense, because you're not looking at the game in its entirety. You got to love it, like it, because remember, you leave him, the game starts at 11, you got to be there all before, which is, I can say that's not true with me all the time. But, you know, you're there like 10 o'clock, and the game ends 6:30, time you do all your paperwork and everything. You're leaving sometimes, you know, after 7 to go home. So that's quite a few hours. You're going away from your house, you know, for the whole Saturday, sometimes it's Saturday and Sunday. So you must love it first.
Now, as I said at the beginning, you wear many hats, president of the Umpire Association, president of Eastern County. There's always something going on for you in the sport of cricket. Why would you take on big challenges of leadership in two significant roles, i.e. the president of the umpires and the president of Eastern County?
Well, it's not a big task, because it's the people that I work with. You know, we work together. When it comes to umpiring, I have, you know, all the support as far as training from Roger Deal, who does all the training. Secretary first was Oscar Andre, now it's Emerson Carrington. Those guys, you know, pulled away, and treasurers, they were all pulled away. Ken Gibbons and Mr. James McCurdy, you know, those guys pulled away. And the rest of executives, you know, they pulled away. And the Eastern County is similar. You know, I got Colonel Edward Lamb, who assists us with my vice president. You got Mr. Dallas Rabin, MP, who assists as my secretary. Alton Cage, my treasurer, and Gregory Johnson, who's been in serving just as long as me in Eastern County. These guys, they all work hard. So my job is easy.
One would say the sport is taking up a lot of your time, but by trade, you work for DigiSouth. How has that sort of balanced itself out?
It doesn't. I mean, I know what we got to do. I said, you know, with the people that have working with me, that makes it easier. And plus, if you're if you try to, you try to be on top. And then the umpires had an executive meeting last week, just trying, you know, to keep on top of things, you know, from our perspective, and preparing for 2017. You know, there's changes at ICC that they do that comes into play in October every year. So we don't wait until April, May to look at it. We look at it early, you know, because usually the umpires assist the BCB with their regulations, you know, whatever's new, what we think that we can support in Bermuda. So, you know, it's nothing that is, that if you do it all one time, it's overwhelming, but if you space it out, it's a lot easier for you.
Bermuda, listen up. D-Music is here exclusively for Digicel customers. Open up a world of music at your fingertips and access millions of songs from free. With D-Music, you can easily search for your favorite artists and create playlists to fit your lifestyle. Plus, you have the option to download music to your device so you can find a song for any moment, even when offline. D-Music comes with 1 gig of free data to stream and download songs without it impacting your data usage. That's 32 hours worth of music. Visit us in-store or online to see how you can get D-Music today.
One thing's for sure, last night I was watching a bit of the England-India and test match, and the commentators were talking about the new rules and the variations of how they looked at it. There was three people talking about it, and each of them had a different view. How do you guys, as the umpires, then pass that message on that it's the way that the game needs to be administered on the field to the BCB so then they can get it out to the clubs?
Well, usually Roger handles that. He gets as much help as he can from overseas. We will sit down together first and discuss it, because him and I, we approach it totally different. You know, I tell him, usually we will do things and say, listen, let Roger teach you his way, and I'll show you the shortcut, right? And as long as they understand Roger's version of it, then I can show them how it becomes easy and how to understand it a lot better.
Now, at one point in time, Bermuda had several umpires on international duty, you, Roger, and others, and still to this day are qualified to do international matches. But most of the times, we only see players getting those type of recognitions. But what would you be telling, what would you tell someone who is interested in becoming an official of where the game could take you?
It's not as easy as it was back in the day when Roger and I, Randall, Mr. Butler, George Francis, Mr. Francis, Lester Hunter, Kent Gibbons, Richard Austin, Anthony Fabler. When we came along, there was a lot more tournaments. You had the Under 15 Americas, which was played, I think, every other year. You had the Under 19 Americas, which was played every other year. You had women that was playing back, about 6, 7, 8 years ago. And you had the man that played a 50-over tournament every year. So you had, and each one of those teams, in the beginning, was like six-team tournaments. So you had 5 days of umpiring, which, you know, you got chances to visit places like Cayman for the Under 15, Florida. I visited Florida many a times. I visited Canada. And, you know, so you got a chance to umpire, which allowed you to grow, which we don't have that much of now. What we've done now in the last month, Mr. Deal and Mr. McCurdy went off to Brazil to do a South American 2020 tournament. And we've been involved in a lot of debt in the last 2 years. That's the most we got. And Mr. Carrington went off to the Under 17 Development Tournament. What was the thing on Texas this year? He went off to debt. And Melvin Best had an opportunity to go to Canada when the national squad went to Canada for his pre-training for his WCL Cricket League Division 4.
Well, and that's basically what we want to be discussing, is the opportunities that are out there, not just for players but for officials. If you put yourself in the right positions, there's constant exams that you do to make sure that you stay up on the rules and regulations. But what do you find challenging in your week in, week out for those, 5 months of cricket, 6 months of cricket?
Cricket is all year round. It's no longer 6 months. You know,
not in Bermuda.
But not even if you look at it from a, like I said to you, you were watching India,
yes,
and England. I was watching Pakistan and New Zealand first, and I the day before I watched South Africa and Australia. I watch Zimbabwe and Sri Lanka, and I watch the game between the Bangladesh among 2020. So there's the big cricket is now. You just sit back there, you watch it, and it helps you to, if you watch it now, and we try to move early in the umpires. Like our training for next year will start in February, which that's for the local exam. Just yesterday, Craig Brangman had his final oral exam. So Roger and I had to facilitate, along with Jeff McCurdy, facilitate that. So cricket is all year round for us because we come under the umpire side, we come under WICA, West Indies Cricket Umpires. So that season is now. So when it's our off season, it's their season. So we try, they give a lot of exams and stuff like now. They give exams also in August. So they do different things differently. So, you know, it's continuous. It never stops.
The game changes from time to time. Rules go a little different. How much stress, and when I say stress, I'm talking about compared to international as opposed to local, does it put on the local umpires when you don't have the, I want to say, equipment or what's available to international umpires to make better judgments? How frustrating could that be over a period of time that you guys must face, being challenged more when you make a decision?
It's not frustrating because we just don't have it. You don't have to, I mean, people can ask for it jokingly, and you know, it's all about your man management skills. How you manage the players on the day, you know, you can work with them. You understand them. You know, I think a lot of folks in Bermuda sometimes we look at things like a player's challenging someone. Every time a player does that, that means that player has challenged the umpire's decision. Because he says, you got it wrong. My guy says you're out. Go up top and look at it, right? We don't have that. So we're better off.
You get that one shot at it.
Yeah, but we say, you know, and we just don't haphazardly give up. You know, we look at the game, and it's all part of our training to talk about what to look for. And when we give them, you know, out, they're out.
Looking at the results of the Division Four, a lot of people were talking about Bermuda getting a lot of LBW decisions against them. Is that part and parcel of guys not playing correct, if I can say that?
I couldn't say. I wasn't there, and I wouldn't be, you know, I wouldn't like for someone to say what decisions I made and not being there, and it's not fair to judge what people do when they make decisions on the field of play. You know, when you look at umpires, you don't challenge them on the decisions. You just talk to them more about law and regulations, what you deal with. But decisions they make is a decision that they see at the time, and that's the way it stands. I think what they all gave out there is what they saw and what the Bermuda players were out, because they all walked off the field. So I don't know what people are talking about.
We're here at the National Sports Center just prior to Bermuda going to the WCL, the Division Four tournament. They played several games here against Canada. Always a lot of talk about this particular wicket, but you get a chance to officiate from time to time out here. What would you say about this particular wicket here at the National Sports Center?
It's simple. The pitch does not play long enough. You, the average tournament we have here is in September, when it's cool, so the pitch doesn't get a chance to get baked, right? The first part of the year in Bermuda, most pitches are a little jumpy also. When they get to June and July, summer, they get a chance to get baked. The pitchers play better. That's why most of our cup competitions, the county game and cup matches, in July and August. So the pitchers are baked in. If we play cricket up here every week, this would be the best pitch in the island. As simple as that. Because the groundsman has the most time to put to it, more than any other groundsman does. So you will see your results. But you can't judge someone because he ruled it, and you can play on in his cool this season when it doesn't get a chance to get baked. As simple as that.
Do you think, looking at it, now you've played and you've officiated, that our players take for granted the pitches that we play on, as far as trying to hit the ball outside, trying to constantly hit over the top?
Fields, not the pitches, the fields. Fields outside. Yes, because you can see when you do take them on a bigger field like White Hill and St. David's, you know, they struggle. You know, and if you look at the amount of guys that get caught up in the circle, you know, it's up to the cricketers. The coaches, we have more coaches than we ever had before. More qualified coaches, all this here. So they must know what they're looking for and what they're expecting. I'm not a coach. I was approached to coach. I was umpiring Western Stars and Bayless Bay this year. And the young gentleman said, cover point. I said, listen, mate, the ball is brand new. You go back with a point. You don't go square. And two catches went down there. And the captain said, well, why don't you coach? I said, listen, man, after umpiring, you can see things. You know, you know what to do as far as an umpire. You know what the basis of coaching, the basis of field setting. And I think they just under that there. They look too much for the coach for everything today.
Do you think the dialogue between umpires, clubs, and the BCB is where it should be, or do you feel it should be more so more information can be shared amongst the three entities?
Always. We can do a lot better. I think we are very unique with that we are small, and because we're small, we should be able to work a lot closer together. I used to go in umpire before, even on Ireland, I came and I actually, Skrillex, you know, I was writing down the names. Who's that burler? He had to call someone else to ask me the burler. When you umpire with Canada and the USA, had to ask, because they don't know. They come from different parts of USA, different parts of Canada, and some guys from Cayman just came into the side, or a guy was away for a while, he didn't know. In Bermuda, all of our players come from under 15, up to under 19, to the national squad. So, you know, we should work a lot closer together than we do. And I think if we work a lot closer together, we will be a lot further ahead than we are.
How does that process start, though? Who makes the first approach? Because it's got to be one of those things where it's approached and then we begin that working relationship.
Well, just prior to the Marinos National School going away to the Rockwick Lake Division 4, Roger Deal and I sat down with Coach Clay Smith, Coach Lorenzo Tucker, and Coach Reggie Tucker, and shared with them, you know, went over the regulations with those guys, you know, gave them some things, what to look for, you know, as far as the regulations concerned. So we always prepared to offer our services, and we always offer our service to go to clubs, you know, and share with them the regulations. Because I think once you understand what you're playing, you can play it better, you know, because you then know what you can and what you cannot do, you know. But we're always willing to offer our services to any club in Bermuda.
Given the perfect world, how many umpires do you think we need over the course of a season to make sure all games are covered week in and week out?
If we had 20 umpires, it'd be fine, because we need a travel weekend, and that can allow a guy to have a time off. Because if you do every weekend, that means any activity your family has in summertime, you just cannot attend to it, you know. So 20, then guys can take a break. You got some guys, you know, right now who are policemen, others who are IT guys, who had to go work weekends and stuff. You know, myself into digital, I'm on call weekends, so every weekend I can umpire. You know, so yes, you know, 20 would be an ideal number for us.
What's your numbers now?
We're close to that, but we had guys who had sickness or different things last year, so it's just about 20 we got, but we don't have them like we like to have them on a regular basis.
Let's talk a little bit about, let's go to the Eastern County. There's always been a lot of talk about Eastern County. Every year, there's something else. There's there's what we consider a new drama. The challenges you faced since you've been president, what would you put that down to, the experiences?
But most of the challenges are things that happen every day in cricket. I think from a Bermuda's perspective, we like to have everybody to do everything by the book, but really goody tissue people in Bermuda. That's why sometimes when we go away, we get goody tissue licks. You know, we need to understand that there's going to be challenges. If you look at the cricket right now, and they're going to roll, Fluff Duplessis was fine, 100% of match fee, reprimanded for, they say, having mints to change the ball, right? I feel they probably are not sure what to really do, so they just fined him. They couldn't suspend him. I mean, I don't know what's about it, so why didn't they suspend him? Now that he's challenged him, they say, disappointed, because maybe they got to find an answer for him. And some of them isn't funny. You know, when people challenge somebody, people are always disappointed and, you know, we're looking for everything to run smooth. Nothing runs smooth in this world, you know. You go in businesses, business have challenges every day, you know. But that's why you got people in place to overcome it. And, you know, some of this year, you know, there's challenges. You just sit down, you got to rock it out. Nothing comes straightforward to anybody.
Open up a world of music at your fingertips and access millions of songs from free with D-Music, exclusively from Digicel. With D-Music, you can stream and download songs and create playlists of your favorite artists to fit your lifestyle. Whether you're working out at the gym, getting ready for a Friday night, or just chilling at home, D-Music comes with 1 gig of free data to stream and download songs without it impacting your data usage. That's 32 hours worth of music. Visit us in-store or online to see how you can get D-Music today.
Are you surprised at some of the things that turn up in the Yancey County?
No, not surprised. Because it happened before my time, it happened after my time. You know, people may not remember what happened years ago. You know, people, you know, it was a tie game in 79 that almost caused a riot down in St. David's, right? Before me, people were known to have had the minute book and different things and didn't want to, you know, have games go on and whatever. You know, so it's nothing new. You know, people feel a way about it, and that's democracy. You know, they have the right.
Why do you think Eastern County is so strong, and has been that way for a long time?
Well, let's put it this way. The senior county started in 1904. The junior county started in 1968, which is only, I think, about a year or two older than, I think, younger than the Rasslyn County, the junior county. So, you know, once you put your time in and it becomes a part of our tradition in Bermuda now, people who come senior Eastern County, they just love, they come for the outing, they come for cricket, they come to see their cousins, their friends. And being the president, I've had a chance in the last couple of years to walk around and actually mingle with my guests. And I'm surprised where people come from, you know, all walks of life in the island, you know, and all parts of the island, and then they come and enjoy the game. It's something about Eastern County they like. Maybe I need to find out from them, but I just got to keep whatever we've done in the past, and we're trying to continue to do things, but make it to suit the people today.
It's always been a challenge over the last number of years because two teams have a field, two teams don't. But how do you work that out to balance out to make sure that it's a level playing field as far as distributing everything amongst the four clubs?
Well, we have looked at the last couple of years, we reviewed the spot allocation funding, and that has helped a lot. Whereas prior, everything just went to the two main host clubs. But now we relocated where everyone gets a fair share of it. But currently right now, we take care of all the expenses primarily for the venue club. Primarily, so that allows us to do so. And we've always had, and as far as being the champions and the challengers, we've given you allotments based on the games you play. So, and what happened has been done by the finances of all the clubs sat down together and work it out. So when they come back to the full body, it's almost like just yay. And it goes through because it's already been discussed at that length.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you about, the fact that how often do you, your body, your group get together with the four clubs to discuss rules, regulations, financing, just new things that will possibly come up? Because every year there's always one team that's coming out to say, well, we didn't know this and we didn't know that, or somebody in a club and not the people that go to the meetings to represent. How often do you guys get together to discuss whatever changes and make whatever changes to the rules?
Each club has four members that sit on the committee. The only person is right now is myself as the president, who becomes, you know, the neutral person at the meeting. So I don't vote on anything. I don't make no motions on anything. I don't second nothing on anything.
You get blamed for everything, don't you?
That's quite all right. That's what my shoulders are broad for. Every time we do something, we got a chairman. But the people under there are a member from each club. So each club has an opportunity to go back to his executive, go back to his membership, and get their view on every topic. Lieutenant Colonel Albert Lamb did the rules and regulations. And Roger Deal assisted them if that so that because he gave them the respect from ICC. And they got a chance to go over the game like umpires to a point where, you know, they got excited. They knew everything. So it's not that, maybe because the clubs don't meet, the Eastern Conference gets the blame for it. But I can tell you, there's never a meeting that to make any changes that every club is not involved. Every club is involved. If it's not involved, we call the meeting not to have a check until every club is involved to get everybody's support. And we don't sign off nothing unless it happens.
Now, let's discuss it. 2 years ago, I think it was 2 years ago at St. David's, there was that big to-do with Bayless Bay, Cleveland County, that dragged on and on and on and on and on. You get over that. What do you put in place to ensure those type of things don't happen again?
As I said, Mr. Lamb, the charity committee, they sat, they met, they've put every measure they can in place, as even to the point if we feel, just when you looked at the champions, when the gentleman, you know, Mr. Anderson, got, you know, felt out of hand. We got it now, whereas we feel that way, if the umpires and referee feels that way, then we see with the police that gentleman is escorted right off the ground. They don't have a chance to come in there and challenge anyone. We put the laws as far as penalty runs inside in place. We put everything from a cricket perspective, we put in there. So I don't know more of him, but I know that we spent somewhere like 2 hours this year going over it. After we had done all the discussion, to going over it with all the captains, coaches, and managers prior. And we'll do it again next year. Before every tournament, we'll go over the rules and regulations. So anybody that is not aware, you know, especially captains and coaches, because they have the regulations in front of them, but any questions they have, you know, we'll be at time. And if they choose to now, they can, from their club's perspective, they can write something to the association and the committee will take and review it.
Back onto the umpire side, there's times where umpires are, I would say, verbally challenged, verbally abused, if I could say that, for decisions made or decisions not made. How is that being addressed from your organization standpoint to ensure the safety of your members?
Well, we make a presentation to the cricket board maybe prior to the season. We try to do things which we're looking to meet very soon to review, you know, 2016 season. And it's just a matter of trying to put in place the basic code of conduct, you know, work with everyone. And we want to work closer with the cricket board and the disciplinary committee, because there's a gap sometimes between the three of us, and we need to close that gap and let everyone know what the process, and even more so, educate the clubs. I think a lot of earnestness is put on, too much earnestness is put on the cricket board. I think the clubs need to take more earnestness for that player, because when a player plays, a player's got on his club clothing. Right? I think desperately the earnestness needs to start first. And I think if the cricket board spent some time with the clubs and brought them along, it'd be a lot easier, because it makes our job easier. Like, nobody goes to bed on a Saturday night, say, we're going to do a game and Earl Bearson is playing. Oh, man, do I want to go to that game because Earl Bearson is playing this and do that? Well, I'll tell you what, the boy hits me anywhere, I'm going to get him out. You don't get that. That's not the way we umpire. So what we try to do is, you know, what we got accused of, right? So what we try to do is, I think, is if more education is done with everybody, it makes it a lot easier. I think we miss that. And I use the example, I tell people, if you look at cricket all over the world, this guy, Kane Williamson, right now, he's the captain of New Zealand. He's the captain of the whole three formats. If they are playing Pakistan right now in a test, if they play Pakistan in 50 over and 20-20, he would go to three separate meetings with the match referee, 50 umpires, to go over the regulations and the similar same code of conduct. So if we practice those simple things here, it's quite easy to get over with. And you can make it a lot easier for everybody.
Is it a little challenging for the current players to switch between, we're playing a 50 over format, we have a 2020 tournament, and then in the true sense of Eastern County, and for that matter cup match, is more open cricket. Is it more challenging for these young players who really haven't put in as much time for the basics? Do you see that as being a challenge?
Yes, it's a challenge. That's why you look at our games, they just about last the full quota. That was the last time cup match lasted for 2 days.
Just this year?
Did it last this year? Was it a draw this year?
It was a draw this year.
It was?
Yeah.
Okay. But what I'm saying, you know, I mean, there's been so many early results in the last few years. And in the Eastern Conference, it's similar. You know, people just, they just about could last past to 4:35 o'clock, right? So, yes, you're right. And we had to look at cricket because it doesn't really impact us there. It impacts us when we travel. Because as you look at it, as the other day, real quickly, we had to play 6 games in 8 days. And I knew as the days went on that, you know, people will struggle. Because there's no, you can do all the fitness you want, not from beach match fitness, you know. So we just got to find ways. We got to look at cricket. I mean, Bermuda's talked about it, saying some bowlers could bowl, your batter bowlers could bowl 15 overs, which may help because, I mean, look at the longer run of when you go on tour, you're helping to get a bowler fit, and your batsman can bat longer. You know, they can be challenged longer. So there's things that could be done, you know, to help to be prepared.
As an umpire, you've seen the what we consider deterioration over the course of a number of years of attitude and application. What would be one of the things you personally would put in place to try to strengthen these young players coming through to make sure that they get the fundamentals, get the basics, and then can nurture themselves through limited overs, 2020, and open cricket?
Like anything in life, you don't do nothing on your own. I believe that if they had a reserve league where you can mix younger players with mature players and don't put this heavy restriction, like I'm not sure about the PDL, they're trying to work, but it doesn't seem to be working. When I came along, it was reserve league. So I was playing for a guy if a guy had 2, 3, and 4 docks, he came down to get his form back as a batsman, as a bowler. So, and you had a senior guy who was a captain who taught you about field placement, taught you the values of, you know, bowling to this side, taught you how to build an innings and everything. I think if we go back to that, because like I said, that's like any trade you do, any skill you do today, you are an apprentice for a period of time and you learn from the older people. So cricket is no different.
One of the things, as you said earlier, we used to have under 15s going abroad, under 17s. Why has all this changed? What has stopped this progress for this the Americas region?
I think the best person to ask that to would be the BCB. All I can say, what I've heard is that the under 15 changed, and I stand to be corrected. At that time, Canada and the USA wasn't producing natural under 15s. Bermuda was, Argentina was, Suriname between Suriname and Guyana, Bahamas. So, but it did us the world of good. We need it. Bermuda needs it. Argentina needs it. Bahamas needs it. Suriname needs it. You know, maybe USA and Canada don't, but we need it. So, I wish that's one thing they can bring back. Because it doesn't only do for the players, but it allows our up-and-coming umpires to get an opportunity to tour, our up-and-coming scorers to get a chance to score, and groundsmen to prepare their grounds for matches when the tournament is here.
Would you like to see Bermuda host more tournaments, and that would give these the same groups that you just named off an opportunity to get more exposure against opposition that they don't regularly see?
Sure. You know, there's something going on right now, and it's pretty difficult because the local umpires outside, like since Roger, myself, Kent, and Richard, they haven't had much exposure. And it's pretty hard for them to actually grow if they're basically only doing domestic games. And as I said to you before, I've umpired, I started in 1997. I did my first international tournament here in 2001. I did another one in 2002, 2004. Like, and then I was doing like every year I was getting some rumors. And sometimes I ran, I think, two or three times a year, you know, to umpire. So I feel for my colleagues now. I really do feel for them, not having that opportunity to umpire. You know, just an umpire in a different country, you know, I was privileged to umpire in Suriname, but Botswana, Singapore, like I said, Canada and Florida quite a few times. But just to go in different conditions, you know, umpire up in Canada, man, is almost a tornado game. You know, you get a chance to use your heavy bales and different things you just learn from umpiring overseas, you know. But yes, we can have them here, and you know, I like to see the American region get back to it. I know everybody talks about funding, you know, and people get funding nowadays, but funding isn't only for players. It's for, you know, umpire officials, for score officials also, you know, to get a chance to grow also in the game.
We talk often, and it was only a matter of less than, 4 years, 5 years ago, the Americas region was the region in which West Indies used to stick their chest out, because they always had USA, Canada, Bermuda, Division One, or knocking on that door. Now USA and Canada were playing Division Three, Bermuda stays in Division Four, and the rest followed down the line. What went wrong?
Simple. Every other region continues to have 50-over tournaments in their region. We are the only region that don't have a 50-over tournament in our region since 2010. The demise, to those who don't know, is mind-boggling. To me, it's simple. You, like I said, we were playing five games every other year amongst, regardless who Canada had, regardless of the United States had. We got a chance to compete against them. You just can't go on a tour 3 weeks to a month before Rugby Cricket League and expect to beat somebody. Part of the way from what I was understood, the Rugby Cricket League was set up, was for every region to more or less help their players. And to explain it a little clearer, each Asia Pacific, New Zealand and Australia, is the reason why Papua New Guinea is ready yesterday. Asia, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, it's the reason why Afghanistan, Hong Kong, Nepal, whatever, is where they are, UAE, etc. where they are. Europe, England is responsible for Netherlands, Scotland, and Ireland. And Africa, Zimbabwe, they're responsible for Kenya and Uganda and those teams. And you look at it, when the Africans have a tournament, they have it in South Africa. When sometimes East Asia Pacific wants a good tournament, they take in some parts of Australia, some parts of New Zealand to give them the best of the facilities. We just don't do it in this region. So I'm not surprised what we get. And if you follow those regions like I do, they are continuously evolving. The Asian, I think, when we went and played in Malaysia and went down to the Division Four, that was Malaysia's third Royal Cricket League tournament for the year. And that was Singapore's second. And they played them all in their own backyard. They never come out of that backyard. So they have home advantages and everything. You know, I think, you know, when you understand this here, and it doesn't get a surprise, but no, we haven't played a 50-over tournament. The last one was here, Bermuda, since 2010. And that's 6 years now. So it speaks for itself.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Douglas. I do appreciate your time. Cricket, we could talk cricket forever and ever, but we're going to bring it to an end with this conversation. But any parting words on what you would like to see for 2017 domestically and internationally for cricket for Bermuda?
Well, I'd just like to see us, whatever plan that the cricket board has got, that everybody get on board and, you know, support them, and we all work together for the betterment of cricket in the country. You know, I said, but we have our differences, but we all got to put that aside and do what's best for cricket in Bermuda. And I just think, you know, I got to listen to different people sometimes. People have different views, but they have looked at it from a whole different view. I mean, I'm always having to look at it from other people's views. You know what I mean? But we can put, you know, put it aside and do what's best for Bermuda. You know, I think we will go a long way because we have the talent here. You know, and I think we can make it. But you know, we got to whatever is the stumbling block right now. We got to find ways of getting around it. That's what I can say right now.
Open up a world of music at your fingertips and access millions of songs from free with D-Music, exclusively from Digicel. With D-Music, you can stream and download songs and create playlists of your favorite artists to fit your lifestyle. Whether you're working out at the gym, getting ready for a Friday night, or just chilling at home, D-Music comes with 1 gig of free data to stream and download songs without it impacting your data usage. That's 32 hours worth of music. Visit us in-store or online to see how you can get D-Music today.
Well, Jay, there you have it. Another edition of the Digicel Sports Show. We've gone through quite a bit of sports here. We've heard from Stephen Douglas, and you know, we just look forward to giving the opportunity for our youngsters and our adults that are in sports the opportunity to express themselves, get their message out there, let people know what's going on. So hopefully, this is an avenue that will continue with the sponsorship of Digicel. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. And any parting words?
Yeah, once again, I just want to thank, once again, Digicel also, but also thank you for people like Steven and people coming forward, because I'd rather you come forward and let's put your head in the ring. You know, so many times we're armchair, you know, judges and armchair fans, and we sit on the sidelines and we do all the complaining. But sometimes you got to get your hands dirty and get a closer look at the situation, because maybe some part of it that you can probably make a big difference. And I said, it's not just a difference for this generation, but for the next generation. We've spoke about many athletes today, the next wave coming through, but that's what we're doing this for. So hopefully from years from now, and they go to the vault of the Island Stats Vault, and they see this interview, they can say, okay, I remember when you talked about me when I was 10 or 13 years old. And that's what I love this show for.
Well, that's it from us here. I'm your host, Earl Baisden.
I'm Juggling Jay. Guess what? We'll see you, I think, next show.